You expect to hear that out of Haiti or Zimbabwe. This is Japan, and they've done everything that Geithner and all the so-called experts tell them to do. It is long past time we dispense with these so-called experts. We not feel intimidated by these people. These are morons when it comes to economics. We should have confidence that if you just sit down and one thing I'm good at, I mean, I'm bad at a lot of things, but one thing I'm good at is explaining this stuff so the average person can get it. And a lot of people read Meltdown, and they say, you know, I understand this so clearly now. Why is it impossible for these people to get it? And then, of course, that leads to a deeper question.
Well, Tom, we know why. They're crazy like a fox. There's a method to the madness. I've read the IMF World Bank documents, as I'm sure you have. I mean, they know what they're doing. They give us all the risk. They get all the profit. And they love wrecking economies, you know, controlled command destruction. And it was great for the oligarchs in Russia when everything fell apart there. They got great power. It's great for these oligarchs. And it's like George Soros said, I'm having a great crisis. I love it. This is the culmination of my life. Close quote. They know what they're doing. And as everything implodes, then all we've got is government. It becomes the central pillar. And so I want you to speak to that. But then also, there's two schools of thought and solution. I believe in the Austrian school. I know you're right. I've studied the history. But we're already so far down the road of big government and crony capitalism, monopoly capitalism, that if we're going to have $14.8 trillion pumped out in the last 7 months, if that would have gone to big work projects and to things on the Main Street real economy, it'd still be a big debt and inflation and the wrong way to go. But it'd be a lot better than pumping it offshore to speculators to then buy barges of oil and park it off of islands in the Mediterranean, as J.P. Morgan's doing, to then jack up gas prices with artificially, so we then pay a tax to them on that. I sure know that if we're going to have $14.7 trillion, and it's our money, a fiat currency, I mean, Bloomberg reported all the mortgages in the country were $9.5 trillion. With this $14 trillion, we could have paid off all our mortgages. I mean, I think that's the message to the little socialist, the little blue-collar people that don't understand this, that, hey, they took your money offshore. Now, go ahead.
Well, I mean, and of course, then we have the additional problem that with a lot of this money that, you know, has apparently been created or spent or who knows what, we actually don't even know the exact recipients. And I'm sure you saw the video a couple months ago when there was a Democratic representative from Florida questioning the laughably titled Inspector General at the Fed. I mean, talk about an absurd title, Inspector General, like there's any inspecting going on. And he asked her, can you account for some of these trillions? I mean, we're just kind of wondering if you can just give us the exact recipients, who got what collateral was accepted. She didn't even understand the question. And one of the most, I think, rewarding moments, I mean, just really, really just joy-producing moments of my life in recent years is the realization that there are people out there who understand what's going on with the Fed, and that now it's almost like all the cool people are anti-Fed. You know, I mean, now everybody wants to jump on.
Exactly.
Ron
Paul's bandwagon. Once the veneer of invincibility dissipates, and once Ron Paul started calling out Bernanke and Senator Sanders, I'm sure you've seen the clip where Sanders says to Bernanke, where's the money? And Bernanke says, I'm not going to tell you.
Yeah. I mean, it is. So, I mean, as much as we, you know, are inclined to fall into despair and think, well, you know, everything's shot, it absolutely isn't, because there is a lot that an enraged populace can do. And if this crisis really continues to snowball and really barrels out of control, there's no group that can control an economy that totally collapses. Then, you know, it's anything can happen. It's a situation like that. But in the short run, people are starting to ask some good questions, and we might even get, or at least we might even get an audit of the Fed. And as Ron Paul puts it, no matter how that debate turns out, it is a victory. Because if we get the audit, then great. But if they veto this bill, well, in a way, that's also good, because then that just encourages more suspicion. People are going to say, well, now, wait a minute. What are you hiding?
Like, exactly. No, that's even better. I mean, we're trying to pass it with everything we've got, but if they cover it up, right as we get to the trunk that's stinking to high heaven, we're looking for the dead body, and the guy's got blood on his hands, I mean, yeah, exactly. Then everybody starts asking, why are you so secretive?
And meanwhile, to me, the amazing thing is, here we've got a supposedly free press. I'm sure you know all about this, but we've got a supposedly free press. They have a chance, the media, to interview Ben freaking Bernanke, on 60 Minutes. So you'll think, oh, here will be some really great investigative journalism, right? Well, instead, the reporter walks into the Fed building, and he looks around, and he says, ooh, wow, they don't build buildings like this anymore. I mean, total lapdog, pathetic loser. And then instead of asking Bernanke, well, let's see, everything you've said has been wrong for the last 3 years. You told us there was no housing bubble, the mortgage market was great, things were going to turn around. Like, every single thing you've said is wrong, so why would we want to listen to you now? Instead, the questions were like, gee, what's your biggest concern? You know, so it was like Katie Couric interviewing Hillary Clinton.
Oh, you care about us. Tell us how you're trying to save us.
What are you trying to do?
You need more power?
Yeah.
We've been bad?
That's what we get in what was once a free society. We get this type of thing where it is the media's role. All these journalists come out of the Pravda School of Journalism, and it's their job not to actually ask questions that would embarrass anybody or would be difficult for them to answer, but to ask questions that flatter them, make them look smart, make them look indispensable, so that we'll all just helplessly cling to these
people.
Well,
that's another issue. Obama cannot talk without his teleprompter. Look at you running a million miles an hour. I am Ron Paul. All of us that love liberty, we can talk. We got our facts and history. And when you really talk to Bernanke and others, and I've been around them, I've confronted them and others, they are themselves these little tight, little, you know, cards close to the chest. They won't answer any questions. I mean, it's really just a big stinking edifice that needs to come down.
Absolutely. And I mean, imagine now, thankfully, there is alternative media that is, of course, popping up everywhere. That's wonderful. If we had in the mainstream media, if we had one-tenth of the investigative instinct, just think of how different a country would be.
But the private Federal Reserve funds all the big mega corporations that own the media and the military-industrial complex. So when 60 Minutes was literally guarding its financial emperor, who it works for. So there is no impartiality there. And let's talk about the media bailout, where the government's going to fund the newspapers and TV. I mean, this is getting crazy.